SATANISM before and after the advent of Christ. My personal experience proved I was unable to piece together the many thousands of pieces of information and evidence I had gathered since 1918 concerning the World Revolutionary Movement, WRM, until quite by accident I picked up a Bible in 1943 and started to glance through it because, I am now ashamed to confess, I was bored stiff lying on a hospital bed, with no other literature within reach which I hadn't already read. Ever since that day I have been convinced that what the vast majority of people call accidents or mere coincidence are in reality acts of God. I don't go so far as to say that the creator of this universe personally does things to us which will, if we heed what happens, seriously affect our lives. But I do believe that he wills such things to happen, and his angels, who are associated with this world of ours, put his divine will into effect. Be that as it may, as I glanced through the Bible I could not help but see that many statements seemed to have a direct connection with events of history and events which were happening in the 20th century. This aroused my interest. Further study convinced me that in the Bible was to be found the key which would unlock the mystery which surrounds what so many authors have referred to in the past as the secret power which rules from behind the scenes of all governments and causes them to adopt policies which ultimately lead to their own destruction. I therefore began to seek in the Bible the explanation of human events with which I had become familiar, but couldn't fathom the cause or reason for their happening. With this explanation, I will proceed to explain Satanism as I understand it. Satanism is the manual of action which puts the Luciferian conspiracy into effect on this earth. The Old Testament, trimmed down to its greatest simplicity, is nothing more or less than the history of Satanism. It tells us how it has been directed since the fall of our first parents to the advent of Christ, who incarnate to set us free from the bonds of Satanism with which the human race was being more securely tied generation after generation. The Holy Scriptures refer to Satan 67 times and to Christ only 63. But what concerns us most is the fact that the Holy Scriptures tell us, and prove, that Satan is prince of this world, John 12, 31, XIV, 30, XVI, 2. Because Satan is the adversary of God and his human creatures, he must, as prince of this world, be related to the WRM. The word world has admittedly different connotations. We can define the word in a favorable or neutral sense and use it to mean the earth where men dwell, or by metonymy, men themselves, John 9, 10, 3, 16, 17, 19, G 27. It's at or the word world can also be used, in the unfavorable sense, to mean the reign of evil on earth. Those who constitute the reign of evil are the synagogue of Satan. What they inspire and do, and have done, is diametrically opposed to the will of God. They set up a barrier between this world and Christ and his followers. To illustrate this, Christ is recorded by John as saying, I am not of this world, I pray not for this world, me it hateth, and to his disciples, you are not for the world hateth you, and so on. John 8. 23. X 7. 9. 7. 7. XV 19. Etc. CF 1 John 3. 13, 14. Thus we can understand that, ever since the advent of Jesus Christ, Satanism has waged a perpetual war to prevent God's children on this earth from putting God's plan for the rule of the entire universe into operation upon this earth. by preventing us putting God's plan into effect, and by preventing us living the way of life as taught to us by Christ, and summarized in the words of the Lord's Prayer, Satanism prevents the masses from doing God's will on earth as it is done in heaven. This brings us to the interpretation of the Lord's Prayer. The preamble and middle require no explanation, but the words, "and lead us not into temptation but deliver us from evil," most certainly do. How can we conceive that God would lead the members of the human race into temptation? He may, and undoubtedly does, permit us to be tempted by those who direct or serve Satanism. The scriptures tell us God will not permit us to be tempted beyond our powers of resistance. Thus temptation enables us to prove whether we are for or against God. I have, as the vast majority of Christians have also done, repeated the Lord's Prayer daily since I could talk. But I never studied the words until I was on the flat of my back with a fractured spine in 1943. As the result of studying the words in their relation to Satanism and the WRM, I reached the conclusion that the words would have had a better relationship had the interpretation into English been, "and let us not be led into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one, Satan." I was pleased to discover, long afterwards, that the Greek fathers of early Christianity, the ancient Roman fathers, and several liturgies were strongly in favor of the masculine rather than the neutral use of the words amalo. The importance of this question is to be found in the fact that if we should be saying, "but deliver us from the evil one, Satan," it would automatically mean that Christ considered Satanism the author of all temptation and all the evil sin we can commit and, at the same time, be the director of all the evils we can be made to suffer as a means of weaning us away from faith in God. These thoughts caused me to do further research, and I found in the New Testament, and in the texts, Desert Fathers, that Satan, and those of the synagogue of Satan, exercise a general direction or superintendence over all the evil, temporal, and spiritual, which is committed, or experienced, in this world. Page 36. Satan, prince of this world. In support of this very interesting revelation as far as the WRM is concerned, we find that he that committeth sin is of the devil, 1 John 3:8, and according to the Gospels and Epistles of Saint John and Saint Paul, it is Satan's empire Christ came to overthrow. And Satan and his agents, agent yours, are the root and cause of all evil, both spiritual and temporal, which ravages humanity. Much nearer our own time, Saint Augustine supports this line of reasoning when he likens what is going on in the world to the city of sin, the devil, born as the result of the rejection of God by our first parents, as being in eternal opposition to the city of God. Saint Thomas doesn't entirely agree with this definite and exact interpretation, so, as happens so often, it is just another case of everybody to their own liking. But when we study the WRM in its relationship to Satanism as being practiced on this earth, it is important to remember that if Satan, or his agents in human form, can and do influence the decisions of individuals so they commit sin, it stands to reason that individual human beings so influenced can and do extend Satan's power for evil over the collective. Thus I found my reasoning to be based on a sound premise when I stated in Puns in the Game and the Red Fog over America that individuals who knowingly or unintentionally serve the cause of Satanism are responsible for stirring up dissensions which enable them to divide the masses into opposing camps on political, racial, social, economic, religious, and other issues, in order that they can then be armed and made to fight wars and revolutions on an ever-increasing scale, so that, if this destructive policy is permitted to continue, it must lead to the final destruction of all forms of remaining governments and religions, and thus leave the field wide open for those who constitute the synagogue of Satan, to impose the Luciferian totalitarian dictatorship upon what remains of the human race. This brings us to another very important question. We might ask, as so many priests and ministers do, if the gates of hell shall not prevail against the Church of Christ, and if God is going to cast Satan and his followers down into hell following the final judgment, what is there to worry about? In my humble opinion, there is nothing to worry about, but a great deal remains to be done before that blessed event happens in order to save as many souls as possible from being deceived into defection from God. We can prove, as individuals, that we honestly and sincerely desire to love and serve God voluntarily for all eternity. We must work tirelessly to bring other souls to join us in that desire. In other words, we must become, as Christ admonished us, real soldiers of Jesus Christ and active enemies of the synagogue of Satan. If lies and deceits are the stock in trade used by the forces of evil, then we must shame the devil and confound his knavish tricks by telling the truth, as far, as wide, and as quickly as possible. If individual assassinations and wholesale murder, wars and revolutions are the means by which the satanic forces remove all obstacles from their path which delay them in usurping absolute world domination, then we must use every legal means to prevent wars and revolutions. Why does Satanism work to bring about a one-world government when powers of which they plan to usurp? Today the power held by the synagogue of Satan is neither general, nor complete, nor absolute. The forces of evil conspire to make their power absolute so they can enslave what remains of the human race absolutely, body, mind, and soul. Satanism believes in no half measures. When it comes to using lies and deceits for the purpose of winning our immortal soul for Lucifer, they operate on the principle, winner takes all. The scriptures in Revelations tell us exactly what the final results will be. But the synagogue of Satan does not accept the scriptures as the inspired word of God. Therefore, those who serve the synagogue of Satan will continue to develop the Luciferian conspiracy in the belief that they will be able to establish a totalitarian dictatorship. They believe that if they can usurp world power, they can establish physical control over our bodies. They believe that this physical control will enable them to obtain mental control also, psychopolitics. They believe that mental control will enable them to erase all knowledge of God from the human mind and thus give Lucifer control of our souls for all eternity. Thus we arrive at the point which reveals what is meant by the phrase, used so often by communist writers, or I should say Satanist authors who write to promote communist and other subversive movements: the battle going on is for the minds of men. This proves that the ultimate objective of the WRM is not materialistic, as is generally supposed, but definitely spiritual, which so few authors and historians seem to have suspected. Reasoning along this line of thought brings us to the understanding of how the words World Revolutionary Movement are only the deceptive words Satanists use to conceal the existence of the continuing Luciferian conspiracy. They make the vast majority of people, ordained ministers as well as Christian laymen, believe that communism is the root of all existing evil, that it is atheistic and materialistic, and that control of temporal power is the ultimate objective. This half-truth is the biggest lie ever circulated by those who serve the father of lies. The truth is revealed in Ephesians 6:10-17, which tells us, among other things, our wrestling struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and the powers, against the world rules of this darkness, and against the spiritual forces of wickedness on high. The other half of the truth concealed from the general public is the fact that the synagogue of Satan control and use the destructive force of communism to further their secret plans to achieve world domination. The principalities and the powers are sections of the heavenly host from which Lucifer undoubtedly recruited many followers. Page 37. Satan, prince of this world, a world ruler of darkness, is the synagogue of Satan, who was inspired by the spiritual forces of wickedness on high to put the continuing Luciferian conspiracy into effect. Thus we are able to understand exactly what we are up against. As we live our period of trial on this earth, we have to contend with 1. The high priests of the Luciferian creed. We will prove that human beings who have been head of the priesthood admit they had the powers to contact and consult members of the celestial world who had joined Lucifer in his revolt against the absolute supremacy of God. 2. The synagogue of Satan, who put the Luciferian conspiracy into effect. 3. The secret societies who believe in and practice Satanism and whose members are the agent or who serve the synagogue of Satan. 4. All those who, because of the lies of those who constitute the world rulers of this darkness, have defected from God and follow a destructive way of life as opposed to the constructive way of life Christ taught us is God's holy will. We will now study Satanism as it is practiced in this world. The vast majority of people, due to the manner in which they have been taught, cannot seem to make themselves believe that Satanism is actually practiced on this earth. Let us ask these good people a very simple question. How could Satan be prince of this world if he didn't have government and the means of deceiving millions upon millions of human beings into serving him and furthering his intentions? They don't seem able to realize that Christ came on earth to expose the existence of the continuing Luciferian conspiracy such as it is directed on this earth by Satan, and by those who served him who are, in reality, devils in human form. Christ made this very clear when he said to his apostles, "Have I not chosen all 12 of you? And one of you is a devil." John 6:70. And at the Last Supper, do we not read, the devil had already put it into the heart of Judas, son of Simon the Iscariot, to betray him, and a little later, the morsel once given, Satan entered into him, and Jesus said to him, "Be quick on thy errand." Judas was used by the synagogue of Satan, not by the Jewish people, and by accepting the 30 pieces of silver, he opened the door of his heart, and Satan entered into it. Then it is interesting to note the words Christ used when being arrested. He said, "But this is your hour and the hour of the power of darkness, Satan and or Lucifer." Luke 22:53. It has puzzled me a great deal to try to find out whether we are in the stage of the Luciferian conspiracy when Satan is about to be bound for 1,000 years, or if Satan was bound for the 1,000 years, as mentioned in Revelations, at the time of and by the death of Jesus Christ. As I have pointed out before, the words day and years have more than one meaning. So could the words 1,000 years simply mean a period or a long period of time, as expressed in the common saying, "Not in 1,000 years." If the words 1,000 years mean a period of time, then the scripture most definitely tells us we are fast approaching the time when God will intervene on behalf of his elect. This means that the day of final judgment is fast approaching also. We can take it that the death of our Lord and his triumphant resurrection is to mean sentence is now passed on this world, the principality of Satan. Now is the time the prince of this world, Satan, is to be cast out. John 12:31, etc. And while those who accept the Luciferian doctrine don't agree, the scriptures assure us that Christ did succeed in his mission. And then we come to an extraordinary thing concerning the Bible. The part that should have declared and explained Christ's victory over Satan as prince of this world seems to have been badly fouled up. I refer to Colossians 2:14. Translators such as Dewey, Westminster, Knox, as authorized in revised versions will show, give different and in a way contradictory meanings to the original words, which I think best interpret the truth as St. Paul wished it to be understood. Speaking of Christ's triumph over the forces of evil, who governed this world until his advent, he corrected the false teachings of those who taught education in religion. He exposed laws and decrees which were opposed to God's law and/or the laws of nature. He lifted a curtain behind which the synagogue of Satan directed the Luciferian conspiracy, and he exposed the lies and deceits they used to cause human beings to defect from God. He nailed the truth to the cross, for all to see who wish to see. The Reverend Bernard Fleming, in an article, The Adversary, gives as his translation of Colossians 2:14, Christ blotted out the handwriting that was against us, with its decrees, lifted it clean away, nailing it to the cross, and despoiled the principalities and powers, put them to open shame, and led them away in triumph through the cross. The task we are trying to perform is to convince the general public that Satanism is a very real and active force on this earth, whose purpose it is to try to defeat God's plan for the rule of creation being put into effect upon this earth. We are trying to prove that Christ defeated the Luciferian conspiracy here as he did in heaven. We are offering evidence which indicates we are living in the period of the world's history when Satan broke or was released from the bonds with which Christ had bound him for 1,000 years. He is now using the synagogue of Satan to bring about the wars and revolutions and other abominations which would, if not, page 38 Satan, prince of this world, stopped by the intervention of God on behalf of his elect, destroy all flesh, atomic and H-bombs, nerve gas, and other secret weapons developed recently by those doing research into chemical and bacteriological warfare, have made it possible for a diabolically minded, satanically controlled mind to launch us into the final social cataclysm as planned by Pike by simply pressing a button. We call it push button war, and to assure my readers that those who bear witness to the truth, as God has revealed it in Holy Scriptures, and as Christ explained it to us, are of the elect, we will quote Apoc 12:9-12. The great dragon, serpent of the primal age, was flung down to earth. He whom we call the devil, or Satan, the whole world's seducer, was flung down to earth, and his angels with him. Then we heard a voice crying aloud in heaven, "The time has come, now we are saved and made strong, our Lord reigns, and the power belongs to Christ, his anointed. The accuser of our brethren is overthrown. Day and night he stood accusing them in God's presence, but because of the Lamb's blood, and because of the truth to which they bore a witness, they triumphed over him, holding their lives cheap till death took them. Rejoice over it, heaven, and all you that dwell in heaven." The fact that the kingdom of Satan in this world is surrounded by darkness, secrecy, as is the Luciferian kingdom in the celestial world, and the further fact that the high priests of the Luciferian creed and the members of the synagogue of Satan hide their identity and true purpose from the masses, and the further fact that they worship Satan and conduct their diabolically inspired ceremonies in secret chambers in lodges of the Grand Orient and councils of the new and reformed Palladian Rite, doesn't detract from its power and influence over the affairs of this world and its people in the slightest. On the contrary, the fact that those who direct the Luciferian conspiracy at the top can, and do, keep secret their identity, and their ultimate intention to enslave what is left of the human race, body, mind and soul, contribute to the success of their evil plans. The fact that Christ did expose and condemn the synagogue of Satan, its existence, and evil influence and purpose in this world has never been denied by theologians and leaders of religions. But such is the power of Satan that he has prevented a true and realistic impression being made on the human mind. The average person has been taught to think of the devil as the most horrible creature imaginable. They have been taught to believe that hell is an abyss or pit filled with fire and brimstone in which Lucifer, his fallen angels, and lost human souls simmer and sizzle for all eternity without ever being consumed. This misleading teaching of what constitutes hell, Lucifer, and his fallen angels, has caused multitudes of people to defect from God and land in the very hell they were deceived into believing a myth. Notwithstanding the fact that the fathers of the early Christian church fully realized the enmity existing between Christ and Satan, and knew that Satanism would continue to work in the dark and use lies and deceits to wean human beings away from God in order that their souls would be damned, they did not seem able to get the truth regarding this all-important matter across to the masses of the people. They taught the greatness and perfections of God and the goodness and meekness of Jesus Christ. They told of the wickedness of Satan and the devil, but they didn't trouble to explain how the forces of evil upon this earth have operated since the fall of our first parents. Thus it was that Satanism, disguised in a thousand ways, and operating under 100 different names, grew stronger and stronger without the general public knowing what was really behind the scenes causing all the evil things they had to suffer. While we don't wish to labor this matter, there is evidence which indicates that with the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, Satan was cast back into hell and there bound, as far as his being prince of this world is concerned, for 1,000 years. We believe according to the Apostles' Creed that Christ descended into hell immediately after the death of his mortal body. Couldn't it have been to see that Satan was secured as well as to release the souls of the Jews who had been detained in that part of hell called limbo until Christ had redeemed them? Then, again, the Luciferian conspiracy seems to have had very poor direction on this earth from the time Christ left us until about AD 1000. Christianity had flourished. It was progressing. Church and state were trying to get along together. The church was advising rulers in regard to God's plan for the rule of the universe, and the rulers were seemingly trying to put that plan into effect. Paganism was dying a natural death under the glare of the light of Holy Scriptures. But as the 1,000 years ended, Satanism broke out again in all its diabolical force and fury, and Satan again became prince of this world. He and his agent were made, good men paved their paths to hell with good intentions never put into practice. They split the Christian religion into 1,000 fragments. They caused the church and state to fight each other. They caused the human race to start dividing and fighting each other, till the heads of both church and state seemed agreed on one point. Satanism was the root of all evil being inflicted upon the world and its inhabitants. Satanism was so apparently the cause of all evil that in the 13th century the Pope introduced the Inquisition in the hope the inquisitors would be able to root out the evil. How the high priest of the Luciferian creed must have doubled up with demoniacal laughter. They sat back and watched the princes of the Christian church and kings of Christian countries tormenting human beings with the very tortures of the damned, and doing this diabolical task in the sweet and holy name of Jesus Christ. All the Inquisition did was torture and kill hundreds of human beings who, if they hadn't defected from God before they fell into the hands of the Inquisitors, would, page 39, Satan, prince of this world, almost certainly have lost their belief in him before death ended their sufferings, considering their tortures were inflicted in the name of God. Can any person with a sane mind believe God wishes his priests to commit such atrocities as the Inquisition? The Inquisition was demonically inspired. It served the Luciferian cause inasmuch as it enabled Satanists to turn thousands of people away from the Church of Christ. The Inquisition enabled the enemies of Christ to split the Church of Christ wide asunder. It enabled Satanism to divide the united power of church and state. It was the origin of those things which led to the Reformation, and from the Reformation on enabled Satanism to split the Christian religion into more than 400 different denominations. The Inquisition enabled those who directed the WRM at the top to put their principle of first divide and then conquer into full operation. What a difference there would have been if, instead of persecuting a few thousand people who were accused of heresy and or sorcery, the heads of church and state had joined forces and taught the masses the truth regarding Satanism, its diabolical direction, and purpose. If the masses had been told by their priests and rulers that the purpose of the Luciferian conspiracy was to ultimately enslave the whole of the human race, body and mind, in order that they could ruin their immortal souls, Satanism would have ended right there and then. A fully informed public could not be led from one evil to another. A fully informed people could not have been led into wars and revolutions. But such is the power and cunning of the devil that those who served him caused the heads of both church and state to torture and kill those judged guilty of Satanism instead of making publicly known the details of the Luciferian conspiracy and thus depriving the agents of the devil of their opportunity to deceive a gullible and ignorant people. By the 16th century, Satanism had obtained such a tremendous control over the thinking and actions of the world's leaders that 32 ecclesiastical and 12 civil measures were passed against Satanism between 1484 and 1682. The power of those who direct the Luciferian conspiracy, at the top, can be fully appreciated when it is pointed out that despite the knowledge and awareness of the leaders of Christianity, both ecclesiastical and secular, the synagogue of Satan were able to restrict Inquisition to individuals who were accused of witchcraft or sorcery. Thus, between 1532 and 1682, 400 individuals were accused of practicing Satanism all over the Christian world, including Nemesis, Carolina, USA. Many of those accused were betrayed by enemies. They knew no more about Satanism, as it is practiced and directed at the top, then did their judges and executioners. In 1776, the synagogue of Satan was comprised of men of great intellect, mental giants who, because of their acquisition of wealth or achievements in the fields of finance, science, literature, the arts, and industry, became literally as proud as Lucifer, whom they secretly worshipped as their god. These evil tycoons controlled Satanism at THETOP. They plotted how they could best use the masses to place ultimate world domination in their hands, or the hands of their Luciferian successors. While individual Satanists, including witches and sorcerers, were busy dragging weak-minded, spineless victims down into hell, the real leaders of Satanism were plotting to obtain mass control of the bodies and minds of the human race so that they could deprive them of their God-given gifts of an intellect and free will. Those who directed the conspiracy threw many a hare to the hounds of justice so that they went chasing a single hare and overlooked the real masked enemy. The conspirators sacrificed just as many Jews and Gentiles as were needed to safeguard their own identity and hide their own diabolical purposes. The powers of evil even caused ecclesiastical and civil authorities to become involved in the prosecution and persecution of innocent children. These cases brought both ecclesiastical and civil authorities into disrepute. They furthered the secret plans of the conspirators to bring about the destruction of all forms of government and religion. Such is the power of Satanism that it extends not only over civic governments but, unfortunately, into religious government as well. It extends over secret societies, industry, finance, science, the professions, etc., etc. While remaining invisible itself, it holds a control that can scarcely be felt but is absolutely dominating, as Mazzini so truly said. Satanism controls also all that is evil in this world, all that serves the devil's negative purposes. Take drug peddling. Only the pushers, never those who control it at the top, are prosecuted. Satanists could not control illegal traffic and trade, and use that control to enslave thousands of victims, and blackmail other thousands of influential people, if the traffic and trade wasn't made illegal in the first place. What we are trying to say is this: if legislation, supposedly passed to protect humanity against the powers of evil, had never been passed, a few individuals who lack the self-control would suffer the result of their immoderation. But once legislation makes the selling or possession of a commodity a crime, the synagogue of Satan can then form syndicates which operate to defeat the ends of justice while making millions of dollars profit for themselves. Thus they extend their powers from individuals to organizations, societies, and governments. I realize some readers will think this is a terrible thing to say, but prohibitory legislation is against God's plan. Page 40. Satan, prince of this world, everything he created can be used for our benefit. If we abuse what he gave us, we pay the penalty. It is a fact that nobody ever has, or ever will be, legislated into heaven. Legislation never kept a Satanist out of hell. Prohibition enabled the synagogue of Satan to establish a government within a government. The synagogue of Satan established a kingdom in the underworld. It enabled those who direct the WRM, at the top, to make billions of dollars while advancing their control on society as well as over the underworlds of all big cities. Today, exactly as the protocols say would happen, the princes of the underworld are lords of society. Ex-gang leaders now own fabulous resorts and legalized gambling palaces in the sanctuaries in which the SOS intend to hide in case of war and or revolution. They set the pace and fashions in so-called society. The proper procedure should be for proper authority to arrest and restrain, and try to cure, individuals who sinned against God to the extent that their actions proved dangerous or harmful to society. If God hadn't forbidden Adam and Eve to eat the fruit on the tree of life, they couldn't have sinned. But God made it possible for Adam and Eve to sin in order that they could prove they sincerely wished to love and serve Him voluntarily for all eternity. Death, as punishment, fitted their crime. Satan caused Eve to sin because she believed him when he promised to initiate her into the secret of procreation and make her equal in power to her, and his, creator. Eve learned to procreate, but God proved only he could create creatures which live forever. That is why we, the children of Adam and Eve, must die. That is why we must be born again of the Spirit before we can be reunited with God. Page 41. Satan, prince of this world,